It said that every revolutionary act is an act of love, and this is an act of love. All power to the people. I said the P is for power, the A for action, the NT because now is the time to get it done. See, the H is for heart and the E for effect. The R hold it down at the end for respect. Who am I, a Panther? Who am I, a Panther? What I got soul. What I got love. What I got pride. What I wanna be free. Reach your hands in the air if you feel like me. Who am I, a Panther? Who am I, a Panther? What I got soul. What I got love. What I got pride. What I wanna be free. Raise your hands in the air if you feel like me.
Can you see the pride of the Panther as he glows in splendor and grace, toppling obstacles placed in the way of the progression of his race? Can you see the pride in the Panther as she nurtures her young all alone? Seed must grow regardless of the fact that it's planted in stone. Can't you see the pride of the Panthers as they unify as one? The flower blooms with brilliance and outshines the rays of the sun. Outshines like the sun. Shines out like the sun. Shines bright like the sun. Brings light like the sun.
P is for power, the A for action, the NT because now is the time to get it done. See, the H is for heart and the E for effect. The R hold it down at the end for respect. Who am I, a Panther? Who am I, a Panther? What I got soul. What I got love. What I got pride. What I wanna be free. Raise your hands in the air if you feel like me. Who am I, a Panther? Who am I, a Panther? What I got soul. What I got love. What I got pride. What I wanna be free. Raise your hands in the air if you feel like me.
This song is dedicated to all those who live and die for the struggle. Panthers, children of the Panthers, and all those who strive for free minds, free souls, free bodies, and freedom and love. Love. Love is the engine to the revolution.
All power to the people. Everybody can hear me?
All power to the people. I hear you well, comrade.
All power. Outstanding. Hey, we're not going to be here long today. Today, we're just celebrating our new comrades that graduated into the UPM. Corey Berninger. Corey, that's how you say your name, Berninger?
It's Berninger, comrade.
Berninger? Berninger?
Berninger.
Yeah, make sure I say it right. I don't want to mess your name up.
I appreciate it.
Maxwell Perry. And Rodrigo Lozada. I say that right, Lozada? Rodrigo, you there, right?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah, you said it right.
Yeah,
Rodrigo Lozada.
Yeah, outstanding. Our chairman is going to say a few words in a couple of minutes. But we really here to celebrate you guys. Yo, Felix said he took his test, but we haven't received it yet. If Felix come on and anybody see him, please let me know so I could holler at him real quick. But the three of you graduated. We sent you the certificate. We sent you the rare book. And we sent you the Black Panther t-shirt, right? Yeah, so you should be getting all of that in the mail. That should be coming. I really wanted you to have it already before we had the graduation, before we met today. But we sent it out. And if we get your test box, get in today, I'll send it out on Monday. You don't have to wait till the next class to do it all over. But next
class, I sent it in this morning.
Where you sent it?
The email that was provided.
Which one?
Patience Row.
Yeah, she said she can't see it. Can you? What's your email on Felix?
Felix S3825@gmail.com.
Felix X3825.
No, S.
Felix X.
S.
Oh, S, S. My bad. I thought you said X. Felix S. See
I see an email from Nathan saying you defended that. But I'm going to keep looking. I'm going to check my
chat. She said she's going to keep looking, but don't worry about it, Felix. One way or the other, we're going to get it tonight, and I'm going to send your stuff out tomorrow. You heard me, Felix?
Yeah.
Sorry. All right, all power. Hey, Chairman, you there, Chairman?
All power to the people, I am.
Yeah, do you have a few words from the new UPM members?
I certainly do. I have a commencement address to the graduating class of 2023. A revolutionary seeks to be in the vanguard of the people's struggles and by example to win the masses of people to direct their struggles toward the goal of proletarian socialist revolution around the world, to create a globalized command economy under the dictatorship of the international working class and peoples of all lands. The goal of the New African Black Panther Party and the United Panther Movement it gives leadership to is to transform the oppressed communities, brothers and sisters, into base areas of cultural, social, and political revolution in the context of building a worldwide united front against capitalism, imperialism, war, racism, and state repression. Comrades, new comrades, within this context, we seek to transform the razor wire plantations into schools of liberation. The repression of the state has transformed America into one big house, a prison house of nations, leading the world and imprisoning the largest portion of its citizens. We should say, enslaves a great portion of its people because according to the 13th Amendment, that is what your status is when you are convicted of a crime in this enemy country or government, I should say. Furthermore, the prisons, brothers and sisters, will be where some of your work will be most impactful. That's where you will meet some of our brothers and sisters who have been dehumanized, who have been made to see themselves as gangbangers, as dope addicts, as prostitutes, and as proxies to the pig class within the prison system. So we're putting together, or we put together, the United Prison Movement Ministry, and I will hope that some of you new comrades will make your bones there first within the revolutionary movement and get that program off the ground. Furthermore, the prisons are designed to strip prisoners of their human rights and to dehumanize the inmates. Our contention, comrades, is that all human beings have a right to be treated as citizens with civil and human rights, and that among these rights is the freedom to lead a collective life with a community of like-minded people. We maintain that Pantherism is Panther love. It embodies Panther love. Panther love is a liberating force. It helps to uplift our communities, our people, and collectively meet the needs of all of our people and our welfare. Pantherism is concerned with the people's survival needs as enumerated in our 10-point program. And this is the basis from which a lot of you comrades will be organizing in your community. The 10-point program is really a lifesaver for the people. It's a survival program. It meets the needs of all of the social conditions in our community, not just single-based issues, not identity politics, but every issue that affects our people, we will hope that the new comrades will be involved in getting that thing organized or advance the revolution. Pantherism is all about living a life of service to the people. That's what it comes down to. It's about being willing to struggle and sacrifice to create a better world for future generations to enjoy. It is, first of all, about liberating the ground under your feet, where you at right now, and becoming the embodiment of the change that you want to see in the world. Our party has its roots in the prisons. That is our constituency. We're not ashamed to say that is our constituency. We speak for the prisoner class, and was founded by prisoners in 2005. People told us then, comrades, you won't be allowed to call yourselves Panthers. You won't exist. The state will repress you. You won't be able to promote revolution and self-defense and all that Pantherism stands for. We decided through trial and error to prove them wrong. We did, and we survived, and we are here today. And this is the birth of that trial and error started in 2005 in an enemy prison cell. So we must be upfront and transparent, new comrades, in our behavior. Who we are as Panthers should be shown in theory and practice. Without a Panther theory and practice, how could you be a Panther in good standing? We must convince the people we will be true to our word, to stand as an example of the new man and new woman. Comrades, brothers and sisters, this is not a game. This is not a chicken fight. This is not a hustle. This is moving beyond the social conditions of exploitation and oppression that has binded us together today. We must be respectful, well-mannered, self-disciplined as we represent the Panther Revolution. When representing the Panther Revolution, brothers and sisters, we cannot act in an opportunist or deceitful way and must be admirably honest and straightforward. This is not saying we're not going to make mistakes. This is not saying we have all of the ideas. This is only saying that if we want to be upright and a beacon on the hill from which people gravitate towards the Panther Revolution as the voice of the people, we must show by example that we represent the new man and the new woman. As Comrade Lenin instructed, attention, quote, attention must be devoted principally to raising the workers to the level of revolutionaries. This is your task, brothers and sisters, comrades, the lumpen element, the workers. It is not our task to descend to the level of the working masses. In this case, we are specifically talking about serving the people, mind, body, and soul. We must build our strategy of base areas of social, cultural, and political power in the various oppressed communities. We must apply the mass line to draw upon their experiences and spontaneous impressions. And these experiences, brothers and sisters, and spontaneous impressions do not represent the ideological and political line of our organization or any revolutionary organization. They are the scattered ideas of the masses of the people. It is your job, our job, to take those ideas, scattered ideas, and organize it into a program that can mobilize them into action. We seek to incite the masses who have a burning desire to transform themselves, to become upstanding Panthers for the people, committed to serving the people and transforming our communities into base areas of people's power. The United Panther Movement welcomes people of all religious and non-religious orientations who support our 10-point program. So comrades, brothers and sisters, when you're organizing with church leaders, when you're organizing with spiritual people, it is important that you organize with them from what we have in common. And that is our 10-point program. This ain't a contest of whether your God is stronger than my God, or whether Allah was here before Jesus, or whether Buddha is the representative of all spirituality on the planet Earth. That's your personal belief. That's your personal religion. And like Malcolm X said, you should keep it in your household. But when you come out into the community, you need to organize with the people, because all of us have the same things in common. And our 10-point program elaborates that. As servants of the people, brothers and sisters, we are concerned with what the masses are concerned with, and stand ready to play a facilitating role, not a dominating role, not a supporting role, but a facilitating role, leading with our ideology that will create solutions to their problems. Revolution is all about solving problems. We must combine theory with practice, and in turn, more fully grasp the correct application of theory to practice. After all, Pantherism is the only revolutionary solution to our problems. Addressing the people's survival needs. We must, first of all, make a concrete analysis of concrete conditions. to assess, brothers and sisters, the most urgent needs of the people in different settings, and then organize the appropriate programs, uniting all who could be united and interfacing with existing groups. And I put that in quotes, existing groups. We have to work with other groups and services as much as possible. Everywhere Black people are concentrated, everywhere oppressed people are concentrated, everywhere poor white people are concentrated, everywhere Asian and indigenous people are concentrated, there are common problems. Poverty, hunger, police oppression, illiteracy, unemployment, disease, crime, homelessness, hopelessness, mental illness, and fear. Brothers and sisters, comrades, children wake up hungry. The elderly need help to survive. Families of prisoners want to see and hear from their loved ones. The homeless seek shelter, and workers want better wages and working conditions. All of these basic needs and more need to be addressed by the party and the United Panther Movement, its mass organization that it leads. To accomplish this historical feat, the party must initiate and build neighborhood associations composed of veteran organizers and respected elders of the communities. Catch what I said, brothers and sisters. To accomplish building power in our community, the party must initiate and build neighborhood associations composed of veteran organizers and respected elders of the community. So if you know someone in your community and you can vouch for that person and they're not a Panther, you should work to build associations that will bring that block into cohesiveness. Programs can be organized under these associations, including the employment of people's security forces. These associations would serve as parallel government formations in the oppressed community and bring in our institutions, nascent institutions, into direct conflict with the enemy's institutions, and serving by extension an example for the masses to show we can feed ourselves, clothe ourselves, take care of ourselves, and fend for ourselves. That's how you build dual and contending power, or what we call base areas of sociocultural and political power. Free Breakfast Program. The party should set as a goal everywhere that that Latino children, Black children, poor white children, indigenous children go without a wholesome breakfast. This includes areas of Africa where our people's land are being raped above ground and below ground. It would take an army of workers to achieve this goal, and it is an army that we must build. Children are not hungry, even starving, because there's a shortage of food in the world. But there are families, small families, that control the means of food production all around the world. And they are based principally in Canada, in the United States, in Britain, in France, in Germany. These are the colonial exploiters today of the world. They don't come simply in a white face. They come in a Black face, indigenous face. They come with a suit on. They come speaking the language of revolution. But all along, the economy is going to France, going to Britain, going to Germany, coming to the United States, the imperial core. Every basic unit of the party should maintain some kind of field kitchen and stockpile of eggs, milk, and dry goods and cereal, so that it can set up to provide emergency breakfasts for masses of children everywhere that you are currently at. Party members, UPM members, should be able to do service in other regions and countries whenever we get that strong. and when they are called upon. It is about making a sacrifice for the greater good. Che Guevara said that in his letter to his children, right before he left Cuba on another mission to help oppressed people free themselves, he said, "Dear mama, I'm putting on my new wings. I'm jumping on a new horse. Other lands call for my talent." And he left Cuba and went to Congo in Africa. And then not a lot of y'all comrades know where he went from there. Bolivia, ended up being assassinated by the CIA. But he put on new wings. He jumped on a new horse because other lands required his proletarian skills. So when the party is strong and we call upon you to go to Cape Town, we call upon you to go to Port-au-Prince, to Harlem, to Detroit, or either come to Newark, it is because we're building and consolidating a Panther revolution that we hope will lead millions eventually to overturning this enemy system. This is a massive undertaking, but it is central to our work and other programs, such as supporting the establishment of co-ops, food co-op, liberation schools, daycare centers, free clinics. Everything should be unfolded around our strategy. The world, for all of us, brothers and sisters, is really one big community of exploitation. Nations don't exist in the traditional sense. They have a flag. They have a prime minister or president, depending on what part of the world you're in. But they are really in the pockets of the imperial core. We are creating a revolutionary panther imbued with pantherism or revolutionary intercommunalism. Huey P. Newton, brothers and sisters, and we advise all the comrades on this call, whether you're a panther or not, to read Huey P. Newton's autobiography, Revolutionary Suicide. It is the foundation of pantherism. The leader of the Black Panther Party, he stated that, you quote, "Using the dialectical materialist method, we in the Black Panther Party saw that the United States was no longer a nation. It was something else. It was more than a nation. It had not only expanded its territorial boundaries, but it had expanded all of its controls as well. We called it an empire." And you should be ashamed of calling the United States, brothers and sisters, an empire. What is it when you got 500 military bases around the world, where you control 99% of raw material around the world, when the IMF and the World Bank are exploiting the infrastructure of other countries in order to get a loan? What is it other than an empire? Rome was an empire. We're not afraid to call that an empire. The ruling circle have recognized this. They no longer acknowledge wars. Think about that. They call them police actions. Look what's happening in Ukraine. It's a proxy war for the United States. It's really a police action for the United States. Its soldiers ain't on the ground. Mercenaries from the United States are there with the weapons of war. It's a police action, really. They say we're having a civil disturbance because the people of Vietnam are rioting. The people are everywhere, and they all wear the same uniforms and all have the same job, which is to protect the interests of the ruling circle. Think about that. The police are everywhere. I apologize. The police are everywhere, and they all wear the same uniforms and all have the same job, which is to protect the interests of the ruling circle, end quote. Huey P. Newton said that the Panthers seek a world revolution, which will establish a global group or association of interdependent socialist communities, or, quote, intercommunalism within a cooperative framework, unquote. Under such a revolutionary system, he said, the people of the world would control, quote, the technological machine which the imperialists have built, not the state, the technological machine. We're going to smash the state and we're going to build the new one. The way Huey Newton saw it, People's China and North Vietnam were just, quote, liberated territory from which to fight the empire that might be lost, as the Soviet Union have been lost in 1991. But that is a struggle, a worldwide one, that cannot stop until we defeat the empire. Mao talked about this, Mao Zedong, one of the great ideological leaders of the second wave of communism, said that we have entered a new period that might last 50 to 100 years, and being one in which there was a dialectic between the struggle in the imperialist countries and the dependent and exploited countries. In particular, he pointed to the merger of the struggle of the Black people and other oppressed people within the United States and the workers' movement. Let's not be too narrow-minded to include the workers' movement in this struggle, though we find the leadership of the workers' movement to be labor aristocrats, sellouts that are beholden to the state.
For sure.
Huey Newton went deeper into this question by pointing out the inevitability of the growth of the lumbering proletariat and general impoverishment of the masses under capitalism imperialism. Quote, as the ruling circle continue to build their technocracy, more and more of the proletariat will become unemployable, become lumping, until they have become the popular class, the revolutionary class. Catch that, not the leading class, but the popular class, the revolutionary class, the fighters, the same way that Mao Zedong argued with Lila San in 1927. He said that we must turn the fight away from the cities and go to the rural areas, organize 90% of the peasantry as our fighting force, but we will lead them, the intellectuals of the revolution. And this is what we're talking about today. Indeed, with the loss, brothers and sisters, of People's China as a revolutionary base area of the world, for proletarian socialist revolution, the empire, our great, great enemy, has shifted much of its industrial base overseas, in particular to capitalist China. And it has become the principal industrial center of the empire. Catch that. Why is China the enemy of the United States? And why is the armed forces preparing in simulated war games to attack China in the next 5 years? This is what their documents state. I read them. You read them. You see it. China is surrounded, not just by the United States, by that flunky Japan, and by the flunky Philippines. So you have to see what I'm saying. China has the second biggest economy in the world. It have 1 billion people. It have a large military that the United States cannot defeat by itself. And that's why, like a coward, it run to other nations for help. Name one war the United States won without the help of someone else outside of Grenada, when they kicked then that little island country of 5,000 people, when Maurice Bishop, the Black brother who was a communist, faced death, in fact, was assassinated. That's the only place they went where they ain't need no help. United States can't fight by itself. It is a coward. It is a paper tiger. And like all paper tigers, they curl and run when the people get after them. The most privileged section of the industrial proletariat in the United States has been shrunk, and wages have remained frozen and even dipped below what they were in 1970 at the advent of neoliberalism, when Chile became the laboratory for the Chicago boys. Y'all know what happened there. Allende was assassinated. With the much higher percent of the people living below the poverty line and being long-term unemployable, many workers, many people are forced to seek and qualify for food stamps and public assistance, such as the workers at America's largest employer, Walmart. Catch that. Panther love to the new comrades that just got graduated. We hope to inspire you amongst you a great, great love and enthusiasm and inspiration for the revolution. We hope to see you in the trenches. We hope to stand by you as a beacon on the hill from which others can emulate us. All power to the people, all power to the people.
All power to the people. Yo, great words, comrade. Great
all
words.
Power.
All power to the people.
I don't really have much to add to that, man. It's really simple. Yo, our enemy is the imperialist. Like this, we don't have to make it up. We don't have to walk around here walking on eggshells, acting like we don't know what we're doing here. Like I've said this before, I said this in other classes during the 10-week period. Our enemy is imperialism. That's it. It's not gay people, it's not women, it's not white men, it's not black men, it's not black women, it's not whatever. It's not all the identity politics that they try to infuse us with to keep us distracted from the people that's still in our homes. Yo, when I get out of my house tomorrow morning, when I leave and I'm driving, I'm going to see people outside that are homeless. On almost every corner, there are people outside homeless. I live in Newark, New Jersey. Like, those are the people that we're working for. That's what you graduated for. That's what you went through these weeks of education to understand what Pantherism is all about. Our duty is to fight for those people. We are the vanguard. You know, the community is gonna hate you. The politicians are gonna hate you. The people in these institutions of white supremacy are going to hate you. So like, I don't want you to, when you get into these discussions or when your ideology causes you a job for you to start thinking, oh, whoa, this is me. Nah, that's why you went through these classes. We showed you what the FBI, the CIA, what the government, the president, we showed you everything they did to our elders, to our leaders, our prior leaders. Yo, they're going to come after you too once you start doing the right thing. You need to understand that. That's why you went through that whole process. That's why you have that red book. Yo, Rod, you got your stuff already?
I got everything, man. I got the that's a different one, but I got this one. I already have I have some highlights on that, and I also have the shirt and the certificate.
That's what I'm talking about. I didn't think you was gonna get it yet. All power, comrade. All power, comrade.
Nah,
but everybody else, that's what you're supposed to get too. If it didn't get to you, it's gonna get there. Yo, I really didn't think you got it, but when I saw the T-shirt, I'm like, oh, he got his stuff already. Real talk, yo. And if it's the wrong size, yo, send us, let us know. We'll send you back. We'll send you the right size. But like I was saying just now, I see you, Zulu. Like I was saying just now, like, yo, that's what this is all about. That's why you went through those classes. This is not a cult. This is not based on popularity. This is none of that. This is hard work. This is politics. You're learning about how we sustain and save ourselves. And like when I see those people, them homeless people out on the streets, yo, as a Panther, it is our duty to find out how we're going to help those people. Yo, when we see people outside hungry, how are we going to feed those people? That is your job as a Panther. That is what will make the government despise you, because the government is ran by imperialists that want to control us, that want to own us. They control the government. And when they see we're sustaining ourselves, we're building cooperatives, we're growing as a movement, they will come after you. I mean, like, it ain't no, I'm letting you know now, I'm saying it over and over, so you understand what you signed up for. Because, like, we live this life. I mean, the White Panthers, they go through what they go through where they at. The Brown Berets, we have a Rainbow Coalition. Everybody that's in this work, that work for the people, we understand what we signed up for. I mean, so, like, whenever you need us, we're going to pull up. But I don't want to hear no crying. Yo, everybody pull up your big boy pants. Because I've made some sacrifices. My family made some sacrifices. We all going to have to make them. And I'm happy to have these comrades in line. Whenever you need me, I'm already here. Real talk, this is big. Like, you're not, this is bigger than you being my family. This is bigger than you being my friend. You're my comrade. So whenever you need me, whenever you need each and every one of us, yo, our duty is to pull up and show up. I mean, so like, we this is our family now. You are our family now. I don't have no fancy words to tell you. I'm just keeping it a buck. This is how I live my life. Pantherism come first. I mean, like, I even talk to my son. And I tell my son, like, when you step out the house, everybody got to look at you and understand you a Panther, because that's who you are. I mean, Pantherism defines you. It describes everything that you are. I mean, that's where your masculinity comes from, your integrity, your character. Everything comes from you being a Panther. I mean, once you understand that and you move like that, man, you're untouchable. Whatever they want to do, we out here, man. I mean, but like, but I'm going to stop talking. Like I'm saying, I'm so happy that I, like, this is our job. Me as a Panther, as Captain Africa of the new Africa Black Panther Party, my job is to go out to organize and meet people so we can work together to liberate people. That is my duty. So on days like today, when the people graduate, you went through the course and you're graduating and you're joining the rank, oh my goodness. Like, this is the best day of my life right here.
All I mean, power so to
I'm,
people.
I'm happy
all
that you're here. Hey, comrade, is that activist coming on?
Yes, Sister Veronica. Yeah, she's on.
Oh, she's on? Oh, yeah. We have a guest real quick. I'm going to let Chairman Zulu take over right now. She's going to tell us about her trip to Cuba. And she's a comrade. She's a Marxist. A Marxist, Leninist. Hey, you in the right room. Hey, go ahead, take over, comrade.
All power to the people. So I wanted someone to come and give us an address about, you know, just the world and her experience in the world. And this is, there's nobody better than Sister Veronica. And I want her to go ahead and just talk to the graduates about what they're going to face. Some of the harsh reality she experienced when living in Cuba. She lived there various times, 30 days at one time and back and forth repeatedly, met with revolutionaries everywhere. So I'm going to turn it over to her and let her go ahead and just give you some of the great wisdom and inspiration that she got from Cuba when she was over there. Go ahead, Sister Veronica.
Oh, hi, can you hear me now?
All power to the people.
Yep.
Great, hi. Hello, everyone. Thanks for, you know, inviting me. Recently, my son and I, I've been to Cuba a few times, mainly in Havana, but this time I decided that I wanted to really experience what life was like for the average Cuban. Now, we were there just for a month, but I actually stayed with a woman who represented the Cuban government, and she would actually travel throughout the U.S. Well, anyway, to get to the point, you know, because of the blockade, things have gotten extremely difficult, and you know, and also because of COVID. So, but the Cubans, you know, are provided with a ration monthly, and you know, there's no homelessness there. People are provided with housing, free education, and healthcare. But even with all of that, you know, they're having a difficult time basically with, you know, meeting basic needs like food. So while I was in, I spent about 3 weeks in Havana. Then I went to a different part of the island. I went to Santiago de Cuba, which is the east section of the island, which is only about an hour away from Guantanamo. Now, Santiago de Cuba is actually has a large percentage of Africans there. I'm trying not to be nervous, but what
you're doing all right, sister. Okay, go ahead.
What I've experienced with the Cubans generally, everyone seems to be like they know their history, they're well educated. And no matter how difficult their economic conditions are, they have a lot of dignity and pride. I never experienced anyone begging me for money. You know, when I was in Colombia and Cartagena, even though they're considered like they are an ally of the US, there's a lot, and it's like, I guess, considered a capitalist country. There's a lot of poverty that you actually see in Colombia as opposed to, you know, Cuba. Cuba, you know, it's, you know, people are definitely struggling, but, you know, you very seldom, first of all, there's really hardly any crime at all. You know, that's the difference between, I think, a socialist country and a capitalist country. There's, you know, it's very safe. You could travel, you know, the wee hours of the morning and, you know, never be harassed or approached by anyone. So
what about the prisoners?
Huh?
Can they come home on a weekend?
Let me tell you, it's funny because I was talking to someone there and she was upset by the fact that, you know, prisoners are allowed to go home on the weekends, you know, and have conjugal visits. You know, it's, you know, which I consider very humane, you know.
All power.
Also, too, what I wanted to say to, because of the blockade, when I was there, you know, one of my friends said that his neighbor's 7-year-old son died in the hospital just because of the lack of medication. So the blockade, you know, really is very devastating to the average Cuban. And, you know, quite a few of them have told me that they would, you know, they want to leave, you know. Any other question, anything? I mean, you know.
All power.
All power. Now, I think you gave us a wonderful, realistic assessment of Cuba. Do you have any departing words to the new graduates? Just based off of your work, revolutionary experience, what do you want to say to the new graduate?
What I would like to share with you is, it's really, you know, important when you have the opportunity to travel and, you know, to South America, Central America, you know, because it's so close. I mean, Cuba, you know, to get a round trip ticket to Cuba is like $400. You know, it's very reasonable. And now the only thing is that when you go there, you have to go there, you know, with cash because of the blockade, you know, you can't use credit cards at all. But I just think it would be a, you know, a great experience. While I was there, I actually went to the Fidel Castro center, which was nice. And I also, that was in Havana. And when I was in Santiago, I got a chance to go to his gravesite. And there are like so many monuments, you know, there that basically, you know, the tour guide talked about the history of the revolution, you know, because the revolution actually started in Santiago de Cuba. So, you know, I would just encourage that, you know, whenever you can travel.
You there, Veronica?
Yes.
Whenever you can travel. Oh, I get it. You put it on period right there. I thought you kept going.
I'm sorry. Yeah, no problem. I'm kind of nervous, but yeah.
It's really important.
It's definitely, it was an eye opener because that was, you know, my first time actually being there, not as a tourist, you know.
All power to the people.
I want to thank you, Sister Veronica, for giving us that wonderful update. I'm going to turn it over to the chairman, Jake, who will have something to say to the graduates. And he'll turn it back over to the captain so we can go ahead and finish the a program. Chairman Jake, you have something you want to say?
Yes, I do. I don't have anything, formal like Shaka had like written down, but I do have a few things that I want to say. I really just want to give you kind of an outlook. The principal difference that I see between, I'd say, your average American or just person in this country, really, and the way we view society is that this is kind of like it's almost as if you're in occupied Europe. And for, you know, indigenous people on reservations in this country, that is exactly the case. And they don't have a choice to wake up in the morning and view it differently. And for the rest of us, once you start to understand a thing or two about class, you don't have a choice either. You have to view yourself as somebody connected to, say, like the underground partisan movement in Vichy, France. With respect to the various material conditions we're facing today here in this country. So that's the one of the main things that I'd like to say. But then the other thing that I wanted to say is a little piece of advice for organizing in the community. You know, there's like all these tropes, right? Like, helping the old woman across the street, right? That's just one of them, but these are like kind acts. They're supposed to be like spontaneous. They're like the right thing to do. They're manners, associated, some of them, but, these kinds of things like helping somebody carry their groceries in or giving $5 to a homeless person or, giving somebody assistance for their rent, you know, if your neighbor is going to get evicted, maybe you throw them, some money so that they don't get evicted. You know, these are things that you would do out of the kindness of your heart. And they happen spontaneously all over the place, all the time, even in the most oppressed conditions. And that's where it's most meaningful. You know, it doesn't mean a whole lot for somebody who's got money to give it to somebody who doesn't. But it does mean a lot when somebody doesn't have money and they give it to somebody else who doesn't have money. Mm. It's more valuable to them. My point is to say, in bringing this up, is that these are kind of spontaneous acts of solidarity, right? You recognize that somebody in your community is oppressed in some way, and you're trying to alleviate that condition. Well, your job as an organizer is to principally be among the masses. I'm not talking about the existing activists, though those people are important and you will and you need to work with them, just as Shaka was saying. But most people aren't engaged in that kind of organizing. They're not engaged in any organizing. They're just living their day-to-day lives trying to survive. And so yet they do engage in these spontaneous acts. So your job is to find those people in your community and to help educate them as to why those acts form some form of solidarity, and to organize those people to meet the needs of those oppressed community members collectively. And I think if you think of it that way, you think about the collectives that exist in your local area, right? The existing activists and organizations. And you also think about the masses, and not just them as a collective, but also on the individual basis, because you will need to speak to them as individuals. You will need to get to know them. And in this outlook, recognizing that you live in an occupied land, occupied by a fascist power, and recognizing the fact that there are people in the class, among the masses, who are engaging in these acts but are disconnected from a collective, and understanding that there are other collectives out there that also view, either in some minor way or in some major way, that this is an occupation, you can begin to pull the threads together to do some real organizing on the ground in your communities. We live in one of the most resource-abundant societies on the planet, and that is thanks to imperialism. That is the conditions that we face. We are sitting on a pile of resources that have been extracted from countries all over the world. And it is those people in those countries who are relying on us to put those resources to good use to bring down this fascist empire. So don't think that anything that you might need materially to organize is out of reach, because it's not. You can get it for far cheaper. You can get it for free, whatever it is. So just be open-minded, be personable, go where people are, do as they do, and get to know them, and build the relationships that you need with those people in your community to build something that can liberate them. That's all I really have to say. All power.
All power.
All power.
All power.
All power.
All power to the people.
The last one.
I'm going to turn this over to Captain, but my name is not Shaka. Jake is Chairman Shaka. The same way I call you Chairman. All power to the people.
All power. Sorry.
All power. All power. And my name is Supreme Imperialist Africa the Great. It's like, nah. Hey, yo, look, with the last little time we have 10 minutes left. I'm gonna start with you, Maxwell. Then I'm gonna go to you, Corey, and you're gonna take us out, Rod. Hey, yo, if you got anything, you got a couple of minutes, whatever you want to say, get it out, my guy.
Well, I'm mainly just really glad to be here, and I'm excited to start working. And I've done a little bit of work in Kansas City, and I know some great people to hit up, and I think this is great, and we're going to do great work, and I'm excited. So thank you.
Hey, welcome to the family, comrade. All power.
All power.
All power. Go ahead, Corey. I know you got a poem for me, Corey. We ready. We ready. Hit us with that poem, Corey.
Give me one second. I'm trying to pull it up still.
I knew you was trying to find something.
I knew it. I always got a choice of words.
Yeah. I'm starting to learn you already.
If you want to move on to the next person real quick and come back to me, that's fine, if that's all right.
Hey, you ready, Rod?
I'm ready, man.
All right, there we go.
Yo, Captain Africa, I just want to say we've been Facebook friends for at least the last 5 years.
Oh, yeah?
And I remember you were more like a freelance activist. You know, you were just recording it. And one of the first, one of the ones that had an impact was the school situation in Newark, where the kids weren't allowed to stay in school because they didn't have the right shoes. And they were playing basketball outside, and you notice, and it was an odd time for kids to be out. And you went inside and you brought it to the attention of the principal. And when I saw that gave me inspiration to, when I returned to my job after COVID, to start facing a lot of the corruption that was going on there. at the time, going back the last 2 years. So when I saw, I came to the conclusion at one point after COVID or after the quarantine that I wanted to join a Marxist, a communist organization of some type. And when I saw that you were already associated with the new African Black Panther Party, I was like, well, that's pretty cool, because since I already consider you, like you say, we consider each other even beyond family, but I always consider you as a friend. And you, I always make it a point to look up to something in your friends, something to aspire to that can help and elevate one another. As I say, each one teach one. And when I trusted, and so I joined the classes, and I like what I saw, and I'm glad to have been able to pass the test and be part of this now, because where I live is New Jersey. We have the same problems statewide, and housing is the big issue. And I see not only have we have gone through our own crisis, housing crisis as a family, my family and I, but also seeing the elders sleeping on benches in the morning, waking up and not knowing what to do with their lives. And a lot of them are from other countries. So I've been seeing these things, putting the two and two together. Not only is homelessness a problem among people who live here, but who leaves their country to come here. So then they become homeless here. There's a systematic problem, whether it's in their home countries or to the country of where the origin of their problems, as Jake was bringing up, an empire. Here we are now. We are at the heart of this empire. And I've seen throughout the last decades studying the Black Panthers of the 1960s and admiring the style and even admiring the generation that did this. And so at least, always wish as a Gen Xer in the 90s, I thought we were going to be kind of like more revolutionary, and then to be, a little disappointed because we took the money, even though it didn't last, but here we are. And I'm going to be 50 this year. And I feel like it's time for us to finally make our mark, or at least use our experiences that we weren't guaranteed. We were guaranteed something, or we were told that we strive or had two jobs, we were able to buy homes or whatever. It never happened, and these are stark realities, not only affected Gen Xers, but also millennials. And now the Gen Z are too smart to even bother with this and say, we're going to change. We're going to help change the system as much as can. But as a emerging elder, we have to do our part as well. And I'm still raising my child. This is something that I felt like was even, it led to this. It was a logical choice at this point in my life and for a lot of people who are also, and it's time for us to let others know and to educate as the vanguard, as Lenin talked about when regarding to the vanguard, and learn as much as you can and learn from the people, first of all, and find out what exactly they need. So that's all I have to say. All power to the people.
Hey, all power to the people, comrade. Hey, look, let me tell you something. Like today, we wasn't gonna have this class today, because we really wanted the chairman and I, Chairman Shakazulu and I, we had a discussion like, should we have the class? Because we wanted everybody to have their shirts and stuff. And we're going through stuff in our personal life. Like when I say there's gonna be penalties to the things you do, my family, Patience, the Secretary General, she started a tenant association, and she was fighting back against the landlord because what they were doing to the tenants, they were hijacking, they were doubling their rent without notice for no reason. They'll go like 6 months, 8 months, then they'll tell the tenant they owe about $10,000-$15,000 so they could kick them out. They'll take them to court. They'll have them stressed out. They'll force their signatures. They were doing a lot of things. So Patience went and tried to help them. And because she tried to help them, they got their Wall Street lawyers and they had her in court for over a year. She lost her home. We lost where we was living at, so we had to get a new place. You see, I don't have my pictures in the background. It's different now. So we were going through stuff, and like sometimes, like people don't see it. People don't know what Patience went through trying to keep her home, like how she was fighting for other people, and now they sent their lawyers to attack her. Now she lost her home. She got to move somewhere else. And to move somewhere else, that's hectic too, because they're trying to price us out. I said all of that to say, like a few years ago when I did those with that, when I did that with the kids, when I went to the school to fight for them, I didn't know you was watching. I smooth forgot. But like you bringing it up just now, you almost brought tears in my eyes. Cause like when you do the work, you're not gonna know who's watching. I mean, and it's hard. People gonna come down on you. And I keep saying that because I want y'all to understand. Yo, the world is gonna come down hard on you because you're different. Because you're just in a criminal society. You're gonna be penalized for that, man. But I'm telling you, just like you said, you saw me ride, it's people that's gonna see you too. And when they tell you that, yo, all that pain, all that struggle that you went through, like you're really not gonna feel it, man. Cause I'm telling you, because this is what you do it for. I'm about to put my video on. Y'all ain't gonna see me cry. That's not in there for you. But look, real talk, but that's what this is for right here. I mean, all power to the people. Yo, Ayo, thank you for that, Rob.
All power to the people.
All power.
All power to the people.
All power to the people.
Go ahead, Corey.
Yes.
All power, comrades. I'm going to try not to take up too much of what's remaining of this time here, but there are two important points of concept and realization that I like to lay out for both new members, including myself, and then if it's a reminder for current members that have been in this for a long time, as well as new coming members, which I look forward to seeing you guys learning in these new classes coming up. It's a very exciting experience, but there's two points that I really want to lay out for everyone. And it's kind of regarding and kind of based on what we just kind of went over, that are pulled from what Chairman Shaka said, and also with what Captain Africa said. So the first point that I'd like to point out is, yes, it is difficult to be an activist while also needing to maintain a full-time job for survivability. Most full-time jobs are 40 plus hours per week, and people working these insane hours are overworked and most times underpaid. There is no balance between work and life under a capitalist system. If there is no balance, it is easy for anyone to be burnt out. Even if you are not an activist and just someone amongst the masses, then you are more than likely experiencing burnout from wage labor and home labor in your day-to-day life. If you're an activist, whether employed or unemployed, it is easy to experience burnout because there is hardship in activism. It is tiring work. It requires an abundance of revolutionary energy. You have to maintain focus and awareness of your surroundings and other comrades at all times. If you have to set up and participate in activist activity, you have to set up and participate in activist activity, you are more than likely to be met with violent forces and even have traumatic experiences. That alone can result in burnout and maybe even discouragement. Being an activist means constantly building up resilience as a revolutionary in the face of opposing forces. This is not to say we should let ourselves be burnt out and remain that way, but to acknowledge that this does happen and we need to prepare ourselves to uphold resilience and the ability to carry on in the face of burnout. If we are resilient, we are resistant. If we are resistant, then we are defiant. And if we are collectively defiant, victory will be achieved. And then for the second point, revolution, this is just the point about like the concept of revolution in itself. Revolution isn't just replacing one oppressor with another, because the revolution doesn't actually end after the oppressive class is overthrown. Narrowing it to the struggle for socialist transitions towards communism, there are multiple stages of revolution that are to be carried out. Sorry, my screen disappeared. There's the proletarian revolution that overthrows the bourgeoisie state with the state of the proletariat that takes its place. State power is utilized for the class and cultural revolutions that follow the proletarian revolution for the socialist transition. Through the stages of revolution, it's vital noting that we are also constantly guarding against counter-revolution and revisionism, because as long as there are revisionists and counter-revolutionaries, security for socialism will be under constant threat of undemocratic reversal of socialist transition and returning to the capitalist road. Socialist revolution is not idealistic, it is materialistic and should be carried out by using dialectical materialism to meet the needs of the masses to improve material conditions of communities. Why I bring that up is because more specifically for anyone that's new to the UPM chat that's gonna be coming into the classes. take that second point and just keep it in mind as we go about as you go about your education. Because I think with that point being laid out, it's going to give an idea as to like what more material you'll be learning from Captain Africa, Chambashaka, Zulu, and any guest speakers that even come on as well. All power to the people, comrades.
Chairman Zulu, what's up with Comrade Rob? Is he okay?
Yeah, he had to work tonight. Rob Rich is on.
No. But I'm saying I want to give a shout out to Rob because without him, I couldn't have went through these classes. I mean, like, well, Rob, you're not here, but your work is here, Rob. I know you at work. You got to pick that cotton, my boy. We all pick that cotton down by the river. But look, Rob, when you get back, you'll hit me up. Give me a call, Rob, when you see this. I mean, without you, we couldn't have got through this class right here. We couldn't have got through this core. I mean, Rob, all the slides, all the information, Rob condensed it and put it into a PowerPoint for us to be able to use every week. I mean, like, yo, this takes a lot of effort, not just mine, not just the chairman, not just the secretary general, it's all of you, it's all of us, because without you, we wouldn't have the class. So next week, we're going to start a new cohort. Yo, whoever didn't get through this time, yo, please, come on, we waiting for you to join us on the front lines. We holding it down for you. We waiting for you. Come the next 10 weeks, We're going to try to change it up a little bit. We're going to try to take away not too much slides, not too much reading. And Corey, I want your help too. Rod, I want your help. Max, I want your help. On the next cohort, maybe y'all could take a class. Maybe each of you could teach a class or something. But like, I need your help. I need your input. And Patience, yo, thank you so much for telling me to give them some time to speak. See, I didn't even think about that. Patience told me that, like, look, they want some time to speak. And you see, my man had a whole book written. He had a whole poem. He would have been mad as hell if I didn't give him no time. He would have been hot. He would have been texting me, sending me hate mail. You some bitch. but thanks a lot, P. Hey, till next week. Yo, I love all you guys. See you later, comrades.
All power to the people.
Love you guys.
All power to the people.
All power to the people.